Well, welcome everybody. Welcome to those of you who are watching us online as well. Thanks for joining us. We're going to be looking tonight at something different than what I sent you in the email. So, teacher's prerogative, right? I was studying some stuff this week that I thought might be really helpful in light of what we talked about last time. Remember, we spent a lot of time really looking at God's love and why love is so significant in creating the type of environment that facilitates transformation into the image of Christ. And tonight I wanted to look at what I think is really probably the most significant barrier in the transformation process. And Paul gets at this in Romans chapter 7. And I put it there on your outline. And it's a familiar verse, I'm sure, to many of you. I put it, the translation I use is from the New Living Translation. And I like how he says it. He says, "I don't really understand myself." Isn't it nice that the Apostle Paul says that, right? "For I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. But if I know that what I am doing is wrong, this shows that I agree that the law is good. So I'm not the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it." Now, Paul's not abdicating himself from responsibility for his sin. He's just making a statement that there is a propensity in us, even as believers, to put back on the old self as opposed to taking it off. He goes on to say, "And I know that nothing good lives in me, that is in my sinful nature. I want to do what is right, but I can't. I want to do what is good, but I don't. I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. But if I do what I don't want to do, I am not really the one doing wrong. It is sin living in me that does it. I have discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart. But there is another power," I want you to underline that, "there is another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that is still within me. Oh, what a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death?" Thank God, through Jesus Christ, we have that salvation. We have that Savior. So what I want to talk about tonight is that power within. We know it as the flesh or the sin nature. We've talked about the fact that we're all born into sin. We're all born with a sin nature. We're born into a world that's broken by sin. That's not news to any of us, right? We turn the TV on and we see it all over the place. But there is a darkness in us, even as believers, that we can give ourselves into that creates problems in our lives as disciples of Christ. In his book, The Emotionally Healthy Leader, Peter Scazzaro refers to this as the shadow. That's why I entitled our talk tonight, "Me and My Shadow." That might put a little different jingle in your head than where we're going, but the idea is still the same. Peter Scazzaro was a pastor for many years in a church in the Bronx, New York. And I think at the last count, there were 70-something nationalities represented in his church. So it was a multicultural, multi-ethnic community. And he wrote two other books, the Emotionally Healthy Church and then Emotionally Healthy Spirituality. Susan and I have read both of those, and we're reading Emotionally Healthy Leader right now. This just came out recently. But I really like how Peter thinks. And he comes at this from a pastoral perspective, so he brings it down to he brings the cookies on the bottom shelf for us, right? Which is always a good thing. Listen to what he says about this shadow. He says, "Your shadow," and I put this on your outline as well, "is the accumulation of untamed emotions, less than pure motives, and thoughts that, while largely unconscious, strongly influence and shape your behaviors. It is the damaged but mostly hidden version of who you are. He goes on to say, the shadow may erupt in various forms. Sometimes it reveals itself in sinful behaviors, such as judgmental perfectionism, outbursts of anger, jealousy, resentment, lust, greed, or bitterness. Or it may reveal itself more subtly, through a need to rescue others or to be liked by people, a need to be noticed, an inability to stop working, a tendency towards isolation or rigidity. Aspects of the shadow may be sinful, but they may also simply be weaknesses or wounds. They tend to appear in the ways we try to protect ourselves from feeling vulnerable or exposed. This means that the shadow is not simply another word for sin. If that makes you think the shadow is hard to pin down, then you're right. Psychologists Connie Zwig and Jeremiah Abrams edited a book of essays where they talked about the shadow as well. The shadow really originated with Carl Jung, who was a Swedish psychiatrist and whose father was actually a minister. And so he grew up in a Christian home. And a lot of Jung's, some of his stuff obviously is not going to work for us, you know, from our Christian worldview and for our understanding of scripture. But some of the things that he brings out in basically his methodology are helpful. And in light of that, they say that the shadow by nature is difficult to grasp. It's dangerous, disorderly, and forever in hiding, as if the light of consciousness would steal its very life. I think it's interesting. I don't know if they're believers or not. My assumption is that they're not. But they're spot on in what they're talking about. They're not referring to it as the sin nature or the flesh like Paul was referring to it as, but it's something that they do acknowledge as existing. And what I really like about what they say here is that when you bring it into the light where it's revealed, then it starts, in essence, to lose its power. And so when Jesus talks about walking, or when John talks about walking in the light, for he is light. When Jesus talks about that all truth sets us free, that, you know, two of John's favorite metaphors, both in the Gospel of John, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, even the book of Revelation, is this light and darkness, this moving out of the darkness into the light, where the light of Christ, the truth of God's word, where the Spirit can bring to our understanding and to our awareness. And I think that's really the secret to really dealing with our shadow side, is bringing it into reality, bringing it into relationship, both with God as a means of confession and with each other. James 5:16 tells us to confess our sins one to another and pray for each other so that we may be healed. So there's this very important dynamic of community, and we've talked much about that, that is essential to our transformation in Christ, because of the fact that this darkness, these propensities to slip back into the flesh and into sinful behaviors or habits that are not becoming of the character of Christ, grieve and quench the work of the Spirit in our lives in regards to our sanctification. And so for us to really pay attention to these things, to bring them into the light of relationship, that's where they start losing their power. That's where they start losing this... those emotions of guilt and shame and condemnation. I want to go back to a couple things he said early on. He talks about it as our shadow, as the accumulation of untamed emotions, less than pure motives, and thoughts that, while largely unconscious, strongly influence and shape your behaviors. Now, we've talked a lot about the unconscious, right? We've talked about how thoughts that are memories, that have feelings attached to them, are buried deeply within our subconscious mind, that much of our behavior, according to neuroscience, is driven by those unconscious memories and the feelings that are attached to them. There's much more going on in the non-conscious mind or the unconscious than there is in the conscious mind. And we've talked quite a bit about that. We'll get in a little more about that tonight. And again, I want to be careful when we're talking about the kind of the cause and effect of some of these things, because I am never insinuating that we are ever abdicated from our responsibility in regards to our behavior. And I think that's one of the concerns with Christians in regards to the neurosciences, is that there's going to be some biological explanation for our behavior that's in somehow, abdicates us from being responsible. Well, I couldn't do it because I couldn't help it. The devil made me do it. Well, James is very clear, isn't he, that we sin, James chapter 1, because we choose to. And that in Christ, we're no longer slaves to sin. We're now slaves to righteousness. And we have the power of the Holy Spirit within us to give us that ability and even desire to obey the commands of Christ and to live our lives in ways that are honoring to Christ. Paul talks a lot about that, Philippians chapter 2. But I want to just reiterate what Peter is talking about here, how these things that are in our unconscious strongly influence and shape our behaviors. Much of the reason why you and I do what we do in the heat of the moment, that reactionary behavior, is the result of stuff that's in our non-conscious. And it's frustrating. I got frustrated just this morning. Shockingly, no. I haven't even confessed this to Susan yet. So I'll do it for you and then for the tens of thousands of people watching us online. That'll be great. Okay. So this morning, I'm getting ready to go to one of my small group of guys, right? A triad of guys. So we're gonna go get all spiritual down in Laguna. And I thought I'd stop for a coffee. So I'm stopped at the Starbucks over in Monarch Beach, and I go in and get my coffee. Everything's fine. I get back in my truck, and I start to head out. And you know, when you're over at this Starbucks over here, it's kind of a weird exit. So you kind of, there's a stop sign there, but nobody ever stops. So you know, it's just. You just kind of roll it, but you pay attention, and then, you know. So anyways, so I rolled the stop sign, and there was a guy coming this way out of the parking area who was extremely upset that he was one car length behind and started honking at me, pulls around the side of me, and, you know, he's in this little car. I'm in my truck. I could squash him. And pulls around me, and then he flips me off. And I'm like, are you kidding me? So, of course, I get all jacked up, right? And he runs the light, and I get to the thing, and I make the right turn and go down to Laguna, and I'm just sitting there just going, what is wrong with me? Jeez, where does that come from? It's this instantaneous reaction, right? I mean, I'm embarrassed because I rolled the stop sign. He was right. Okay, fine. Have you ever done that to anybody? You know, I wanted to say that to him. But I just realized as I was driving to meet with the guys that the stuff that comes out of us just like that, that's the kind of stuff we're talking about. That's where character transformation needs to happen in there, so that when we react to things, we're reacting in a way that's consistent with what Christ is doing in us. So obviously, I'm still a work in progress. But I'm encouraged because even the Apostle Paul struggled with that, right? Now, I don't know if he had road rage with Starbucks in his hand, but you know, surely there was some chariot issues at some point in their day, right? I think chariot rage was a problem in the first century. Okay, all right, so we
will. Never drive.
Yeah, I know. I need a driver, right? That would solve a lot of problems in my life. Okay, all right. So we're talking about things that are going on in our non-conscious. Dr. Karen Lee refers to it that are our unconscious. Most of us are more familiar with that phrase. And how those memories can get triggered in a flash and result in behavior that we're just like, ay, 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 ay. Now, this morning's incident, thankfully, was didn't escalate into something significantly bad. Although, if he would have stopped and pulled over, he was an older guy, could have taken him easy. But if he would have stopped, and pulled over, I honestly was not in a good frame of mind. I probably would have said some things to him that I would have regretted saying. And it's so interesting to me when you get into this place where your adrenaline's pumping and you're just all fired up. And I know my adrenaline was pumping because 2 minutes afterwards you start shaking, right? And it's interesting how the body responds to situations. When you're in a fight situation, it triggers the the primitive part of your brain, which is their fight or flight mode. Adrenaline gets shot into your system, and everything gets all ramped up because you're ready you're either ready to fight or you're ready to run. That's just God. Those are the instinctive reactions that God created us with. And someday I hope I will choose to not react. That would be really a nice thing. Sometimes, though, the things that are inside of us in these shadow places wreak incredible havoc in our lives. I want to read a true story to you that's out of Peter's book. I put it there on your outline as well. And I want to read this story to you because I think it is instructive, sadly instructive, of the world that many pastors live in today. Because there's, and not just pastors, many Christians live in today because they don't believe that there is a safe place for them to go and let this, and expose this junk to the light. The bottom line is this, friends. Whatever we keep hidden in the darkness, the dark parts of ourself, are going to manifest themselves in some form or fashion that is not going to be consistent with what we want to be and what Jesus wants us to be as his disciples. And so we so desperately need each other to be safe, to have safe places with each other where we hear truth, but within the context of grace. And we're never going to face the truth about what's deeply in ourselves unless we know that there's grace. Jesus, John 1:12, John said that Jesus came full of two things. Remember they were? Grace and truth. And I think John put him in that order on purpose. He didn't say truth and grace. He said grace and truth. Why? Because I think we need grace before we're willing to face the truth. If we think that we're going to bring the reality of who we are into a situation where we can be rejected, condemned, criticized, or judged, we're going to hide. We're not going to do that. And so the Christian community, we should be the safest place on earth for each other. Because we all know what's going on inside of us. The Apostle Paul referred to himself as the chief sinner. And so he was able to extend grace to others because of the grace he had received himself. But if we never look at the stuff that's deep inside of us, we're never going to bring that into a place of grace. We're never going to receive God's grace and love and forgiveness. And if we don't receive that from him, how in the world can we give that to anybody else? How can we be conduits of grace, as Peter says in 1 Peter 4:10? How can we be conduits of grace in its various forms unless we have received it ourselves? Larry is a 41-year-old founding pastor of a rapidly growing church. He and his wife, Rebecca, have been married for 20 years and have four children. In his 18 years leading the church, the congregation has grown from a core group of 100 to more than 4,000 with 35 staff. Larry is friendly, easygoing, and loved by his team. Things with the church and his life seem to be going well until the day he abruptly submitted his resignation to the personnel committee. He said he was burnt out from the last few years, especially after completing a recent capital campaign for a new worship center. It turned out, however, that there was much more to the story. A recent visitor to the church had encountered Larry with another woman at a hotel in a nearby city. And it was not a random encounter, but a three-year on-again, off-again affair. Larry seemed to think his resignation would somehow prevent the news from being discovered by the church, but it was too late for that. Later, it was also discovered that Larry had accumulated a sizable financial debt in recent years. Larry resigned. His marriage ended. The church was left to pick up the pieces. It's a sadly familiar story, isn't it? But there is another aspect to the story that raises issues every Christian leader, and I would say every Christian, needs to grapple with. During the 3 years that Larry's life was going off the rails, the church was thriving. Attendance increased by 700. Many people came to faith in Christ. The giving and the ministry budget increased, and the church's impact on the community expanded. Larry even preached a popular series on biblical marriage and family life for 6 weeks during that time. Somehow the church experienced short-term success, even when something was terribly wrong at the leadership level. But after Larry's resignation, the church swiftly spiraled downward. People felt betrayed and deceived. Fingers were pointed. Resources and energies once devoted to outreach were redirected to helping people within the church grieve and heal. The budget was slashed by 40%. This meant that ministries, both locally and internationally, were discontinued or radically cut back. Frustrated church members wanted to know why staff and members of the church board hadn't noticed any early warning signs of Larry's problems. At the end of a quarterly congregational meeting in which this issue was raised, the board's chairperson summarized the board's response. "We saw things that concerned us," he said. "Larry was always on the move, juggling new projects, speaking at conferences, hiring new staff. It was hard for us to keep up with how quickly the church was changing. None of us probed and asked deeper questions. The reality is, we were so caught up in the excitement over things like the new building campaign and the attendance numbers skyrocketing that we disregarded what we did notice. And we attributed his behavior to the normal stress that comes with growth." A long pause followed. The room grew painfully quiet. The board chair quietly acknowledged with many others what many others were thinking. He said, "What makes this whole situation so hard to understand is that some of our most powerful weekend services took place during the 3 years he was having his affair." Peter goes on to say, this isn't on your outline, but I want to read it for you. "If you're a leader in a church, the board chair's statement has to hit you right in the gut. Somehow, it has become part of our default thinking that external markers of success are an indication that all must certainly be well at the leadership level. We wouldn't be successful otherwise, right? But as Larry's story demonstrates, it is possible to build a church, an organization, or a team by relying only on our gifts, talents, and experience. We can serve Christ in our own energy and wisdom. We can expand a ministry or a business without thinking much of Jesus or relying on Him in the process. We can boldly preach truths we don't live. And in our efforts prove successful, and if our efforts prove successful, few people will notice or take issue with the gaps between who we are and what we do." That is a tragic story. And maybe even more tragic is the reality and the assumptions that as long as everything on the outside looks good, everything's fine. And so if we measure maturity, effectiveness, growth, if we measure what we think God wants, let's say, by outwardly demonstrative means, and that's the only measure we use, the only metrics we use, we're going to be in serious trouble. Now, I'm not saying that church growth and health and budgets and all of those things are not a way of measuring what's going on at the church, because I believe that it is. But it is certainly not the most important thing. Certainly not. And the translation into our lives as Christians is very similar. That we can look great on the outside when there is much wrong on the inside. And it's this distance between who we are, who we know ourselves to be, and the person that we project ourselves to be with other people. And so often, we don't want to do that, but we have the mask up because we think that's what other people want to see, and we believe that that's the only person that I'm going, that's the only way that I'm going to get people's love and affection, which we need. And so we maintain this facade, we wear this mask, we keep the armor on, because we're afraid that if we take it off and people see who we really are, what the problems we really have, and the things we really think, that we're going to get rejected and abandoned. And so we just keep up the pretense. And it's the walking dead. It really is. And we just perpetuate it. We perpetuate it because of our fear. If our greatest need is love and relationship, our greatest fear is rejection and abandonment. And we've talked much about how God created us as relational beings in His image and likeness. Therefore, we need love. I read a number of studies this week from secular scientists who are trying to measure love. And I shared some of that with you last time. We looked at Dr. Harlow's experiments with the monkeys and stuff. I read probably 5 or 6 other studies this week that show the biological necessity of love. That if we don't have love, if we don't experience love, if we don't experience touch and other and human connection, we will literally die. But there's so many people, I'm afraid, who aren't literally dead. They're still existing, but there's really no life there. They're zombies. They're walking around, they're the walking dead emotionally, because they're just terrified of letting anybody inside to know who they are. And what happens is, like with Larry, it takes energy to hold that mask up. It takes effort. And over time, you just get tired. And so you either drop it and just take the risk because you have no other option, or everything blows up, so you have no other choice. And that's sadly what tends to happen to a lot of pastors, especially, is that, you know, where is Larry supposed to go? If let's say we rewind the tape a year before this happened, what would have happened if he would have gone to his elder board, if he would have said, you guys, there's just some broken things in me now. I'm a mess. I need some help. Can I get some counseling? Will you guys give me a couple months sabbatical? You know, most elder boards are not going to look favorably on that. You're supposed to have your act together. Are you kidding me? What kind of a spiritual leader are you? And so we just bury the stuff down. I was reading some statistics today that the pornography epidemic, not only with Christian men, also with Christian women, but the shocking statistics with pastors. And in a study done a few years ago by pastors.com, the pastors they surveyed, these are obviously anonymous surveys, confessed to 54% of them having viewed pornography within the last year. Now, pornography, again, like any other addiction, is a problem, but it's not the problem. There is always something else driving it. And so pornography, for example, is an intimacy issue. It's a false intimacy where I am responding to something because I'm afraid of connecting in a healthy way with my husband or wife. And so it's this pseudo community. It's this false love that we look for to fill that gap, to fill that void in us. And the shadow self, the shadow part of us, and the spiritual warfare that I think is a part of all of this, especially for us as believers, is Satan just jumps on the bandwagon and he just pushes it in even deeper. How can you call yourself a Christian? You've got to be kidding me. And so then all this guilt, all this shame, all this condemnation, and we just wither and die in everything. Larry Crabb wrote a book in 1999. I mean, that feels like eons. I mean, my kids were really born in 1999. And it's called, he titled it The Safest Place on Earth. And it was the beginning of his transition in his theoretical orientation of doing psychotherapy to really creating an environment, a safe environment of grace that he calls them spiritual communities, where we can just basically be real with each other and take our masks off. And it's his belief, and I haven't seen anything that he's written lately. It's his belief that, at least from this book and some of the other things that he wrote not long afterwards, that much of the healing that we need as people, as believers, outside of the biological issues that are very real, can be dealt with and handled and healed within a community
of loving believers. And that just makes sense, doesn't it? Mm-hmm. Because if we're the body of Christ, and as individuals, we have the Holy Spirit dwelling within us, we are God's plan A in helping each other grow. That the Spirit works through the body to be conduits of His grace and love and His mercy. Yes, we know about those things through the Scripture. Of course we do. But we experience those things. I'm going to talk to you about the different ways of knowing. There's two ways of knowing and how our brain works. If all we do is know the facts and the information about God's love and forgiveness, that's not going to reach our heart. It just stays in our head. And if we're living behind a mask, the mask is what gets loved, not me. And so that's part of the deception, is that when I have a mask up and people seem to be, that they're accepting me and they're liking me and they're loving me and all that. No, they're not. They're just loving the mask. Until you can take that mask down and then experience the unconditional love of God, the mercy of God, and the grace of God, as believers are conduits of, whatever that stuff is that's percolating underneath, that's trying to come up out, that stuff does not get killed. It just festers. That is the number one reason, I believe, why we have a blockage in our transformation as believers in North America specifically. That there's a sanctification gap because of unresolved emotional wounds. And we're all wounded. We're all broken because we've all experienced sin. And so, what do we do with that? Where do we take that? Peter goes on to talk about some ways that you can acknowledge your shadow self. And I put these there on your outline as well. Not that we need any help, quite frankly, knowing that we have this, because I think we all do. But these are some pressure points. He says, you act out inappropriately when under pressure. Yes, I did that this morning. You don't want someone to succeed because they've hurt you. You're triggered by a person or circumstances and say things you later regret. Disregard your spouse or coworkers when they bring up a difficult issue about you and your behavior. Keep doing the same thing over and over, even though the consequences remain negative. Are angry, jealous, and envious a lot. Do and say things out of fear of what other people think. I never do that. Not. Get busier rather than more reflective when you're anxious. Tend to idealize others who seem to have been given special gifts by God, forgetting they too have a shadow and are broken just like you. Make negative comments to others about those who frustrate you rather than go to them directly. These are just some ways. Of course, none of these resonate with anyone in this room. But hypothetically, these would be things that would be an indication of that. Okay, so as you can see on your outline, there is a kind of an assessment of how you're doing with your shadow side. I want to invite you to just take a few minutes and go. I'm not going to have you share the results with everybody, okay? I want this to be a safe place. So, but if you're willing to take this, I think it might be instructive for you at some later point, both to help you assess the extent to which you're willing to deal with reality or the extent to which you're in denial. And I always think that's a good thing. And so if you're willing to take the assessment, I want to give you a few minutes to do that. And then I'm going to have us break into groups, but I'm not to talk about that necessarily. I want you to interact about the case study that we looked at. And in light of everything that we've been talking about for the last 3 months, and some of the things that I reminded you of tonight, what do you think was going on with Larry? And if you were on a church board, if you were on Larry's church board, how would you handle that situation if Larry would have come to you a year before? And why? Okay, so why don't we take 5 minutes or so, probably take 5 to 6 minutes for you to go through the assessment, and then I'll break this up into groups after that. I wanted you to take this tonight is A, because if you do it here, then you'll do it. Taking it home, you might not. And I think it's a valuable exercise. I also put on your outlines, you can see, just an explanation of the numbering and how it comes together. I also wanted you to go through that because I think some of this will be pertinent to the case study for your discussion as well. So why don't you go ahead now and just kind of break up into groups like you've been doing, just 3 or 4 people or whatever, just kind of right next to your area, and take 10 minutes or so to just talk about Larry. What you think maybe was going on with Larry, why you think maybe he did some of the things that he did, and then get to that point, and what you would do as a board member if you were on the board of that church, how you would help Larry and process that. All right. I wanted to just take a few minutes and talk to you about a couple more things in that I think will be helpful as we continue this kind of direction that we're talking about. And the first is, we looked at last week the barriers to love is hiding behind a suit of armor where we are protecting ourselves or pretending that we're something we're not. And when we're wearing a mask, there's a distance between who we know we truly are and who we're presenting ourselves to be. And that distance creates a lot of pressure that over time lends itself to meltdown. You can think of it like trying to hold a beach ball underwater. You can do it for a little while, but you get tired at some point and it's gonna slip out, it's gonna rocket to the top and everybody's gonna know. And so that's why creating an environment of grace, I really believe, is what is needed in our day, in our Christian subculture. And I'll speak specifically to North America. But I just don't think we feel safe. And if we can start creating communities, pockets of communities with each other and with smaller groups, I think the transformation that we're going to see could be truly, truly incredible. Now, I mentioned earlier that there's two ways of knowing. There's two primary circuits that transfer knowledge or help us to know something. The first one is what the neuroscientists refer to it a number of different ways, but they refer to it as the high road or explicit knowledge. This is a way of knowing that's based on facts. It's based on information. It's cognitive. It's conscious, so you're aware of it. It's something that you can control. It's with words and symbols that are visible and measurable. So that's one avenue of getting information, for us getting information. But there's another avenue, and both of these circuits work differently. And the other one is what they call the low road or implicit knowledge. This is non-conscious. It is something you can't direct or control. It's automatic. So when you have an automatic response to something, like if you're driving down the road and you're looking down at your cell phone, or God forbid you're texting, and you look up and you see brake lights, what do? Do you think to yourself, gosh, I better put my brakes on right now, because if I don't, I'm probably going to run into that person, then my insurance is going to go through that dialogue? No, you slam your brakes on. It's an instantaneous reaction. Why? Because you're habituated to, when you see brake lights, bam, you get your brakes. You don't have to think about it. That's what's going on basically in this low road or non-conscious mind. This is a way of knowing that is experiential, it's relational, it's intuitive. They call it a gut, your gut feeling. And you know that. There's been certain times where you haven't had you haven't had concrete knowledge about something, but you just know there's just not, something's not right here. Yeah, I just feel it in my gut, right? And some of us are more intuitive than others. Probably the ladies are a little more intuitive than most men, but I know a lot of men that are fairly intuitive as well. Why I think this is important is because if you limit yourself to only high road knowledge, that does not get to your heart. That's head knowledge. You have to have the other circuit working alongside with this so that you are experiencing what it is that you know. So, for example, you can know all day long that God loves you. You can have all the best theology. You can know Jesus died for your sin. You can know all of the results of that, that I'm adopted, that I'm sanctified, that I'm redeemed, that you can know all that stuff. But if you don't ever experience God's love through community, in relationship with others, it is not going to get into your heart and provide you with what you need and what God wants you to have. And so the same is true on the flip side. If all you do is experience, you know, and have emotions about things, that's great, but you need the other as well. So these two work in tandem. And I would suggest to you that it's a 50-50 proposition. Isn't it interesting that Jesus came in the flesh? Why did he do that? God could have just given us the Bible. God could have just written it in the sky. He could have just communicated in a cognitive way, but he didn't. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Why? Because God created us. He knows what we need. Jesus came full of grace and truth. Why? Because he wired our brains to process information that way. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
And so I had a conversation with a friend this morning, and if he were here, he was going to share with you tonight. So he's not here, so I'll share with you anyways, because he said I could. He's in a situation where he is, both of his girls are getting married, and he's just been feeling stressed lately. Now, his stress isn't financial. That's not what most of our stress would be. Like, how am I going to pay for this? That's not his issue. But what he said this morning, I was so encouraged by it, is he said, I realized that this season is coming to an end. And so my snippiness is a result of this sadness that I'm feeling. And even when he was talking about it, he said, I can't believe how sad I really am. He said, I was working on my Father of the Bride speech. He said, I started bawling. And I couldn't stop. What is wrong with me? And I'm like, dude, there's nothing wrong with you, you know? But that's where we go. Because to express emotion in our culture, there's something wrong with you. You know, Dan was sharing just in his ministry experience in Africa, how Africans are very open with their feelings and emotions. And I haven't worked as much in Africa. I've worked a lot with Asian cultures in Myanmar, which, you know, by China, where they're completely opposite. You know, it's all about face, it's all about honor, it's all about the pretense. You don't let your guard down at all. So when I've got a group of pastors, and I wanted to put them in a circle and have them start sharing with each other, they were looking at me like I was the man on the moon. You know, I was like, what are you doing? But as we kind of broke them down, you know, over the 3 days that I had with them, by the end of that time, we were all sitting in a group sharing, and it was powerful. It was unbelievable. And so, I can't stress enough how important this is. Because we so minimize emotions. In our Christian culture, we minimize emotions. We are so into head knowledge. We are so into having right theology, being right about everything, and that's good. You know me well enough. You know I love that, and I think that's important. But we do it to the detriment of emotion. God gave you emotions for a reason. Emotions are an indication that something's going on. It's like when the red light comes on your dashboard, what do? You don't keep driving it. No, you don't ignore it. That's the last thing you do. Why? Okay. How many guys in here would say you don't ignore the red light on the dashboard, all right? I know there's some women too. Okay. Because that's usually an indication you're out of oil, and by the time the light comes on, you're already in trouble. Okay. And you can't drive a car without oil because it stops. Everything seizes. And so it's kind of like life. You can't drive the love bug of life without love, right? Because it's going to seize up. Okay, so here's what I was talking about in regards to what's going on in the subconscious. Oops. There is a lot more going on under the surface of your, remember we talked about our heart as our inner being, so the synonymous terms in scripture are mind, heart, inner being. Paul uses the phrase inner being in Ephesians. Mm-hmm. And so what he's referring to, and we've gone into great detail on this over the last few months, is that there is a lot, and all of these are thoughts that are memories, and those have emotions attached to them. So you can't have a memory about something without having some kind of emotion attached to it. Now, you may not be in touch with that emotion, but emotions, feelings are attached to every memory you have, every thought you have. And so what happens in our day-to-day experiences is that something will happen in our day that triggers a memory that creates a response. Now, this doesn't have to all be bad stuff. It can be good stuff, too. But what's interesting is that there's a vast neural network, right, in our brains that are all interconnected. And so when you have a memory that's in the subconscious mind that gets triggered by something that's in your conscious mind, that is then brought up to your conscious mind and becomes a much bigger deal. Does that make sense?
Yes.
So with my friend, and usually you can tell that something, the deeper, the more emotion that's attached to it is usually an indication of the deeper something's buried. I don't have a 1-to-1 ratio for you, but that's usually a good indication. So with my friend, as we were talking about this, I said to him, I said, you know, it's possible that the intensity of your emotion is not just about your daughter's, this chapter coming to close, that you may discover that there's some other things that are attached to that, because all of these things are hooked together in some form or fashion. And what was interesting is as we were talking about it, he's like, and so there were things, even in our conversation, that were in his non-conscious mind that were being pulled up now into his conscious mind. And then what happens is then you start paying attention to your dreams. Because remember, our non-conscious is going 24/7. When we go to sleep, our conscious mind goes to sleep, but not our non-conscious mind. Our non-conscious mind never stops. And remember that the non-conscious mind is processing 400 billion things a second. Whereas the conscious mind, it's like the difference between an Indy car and a snail. I mean, there is so much going on because it's in our non-conscious. This is what is regulating our breathing, our heart rates, our cell reproduction, all the things that you're not even aware of until you make yourself aware of it, right? You haven't even been aware of your breathing tonight. But now you are, right? Because you're paying attention. And so what we pay attention to is what starts being moving around in here. This stuff is all, remember the brain is plastic. The brain is always, it's malleable, it's changing. You're growing new neurons as you're learning new things. And these are getting connected to other things. And so when you've got information coming in, both from the high road and low road, that is what you need to be paying attention to and to get the full benefit of what it is, in essence, that God wants to say to you. It's not just getting more head knowledge. It's not just more information. As good as all of that is, God didn't limit his revelation to us in written form. Jesus came in the flesh. He gave us general revelation in addition to special revelation. And so God is revealing himself to us in a multitude of different ways. And we're missing out on that if all we're doing is paying attention to high road knowledge and information. This is why relationships are essential in our sanctification and in our growth in Christ. Because you cannot experience the love of God in isolation. It's impossible. And if you don't experience love, you're not going to grow. You will be handicapped in your growth and development. And that's true biologically, physiologically, and it's true emotionally. And so it's essential, coming back to what we started with earlier, that we feel safe in relationship with each other so that we can be real with each other, so that we can experience the love that we need. Because love is what makes things grow. Love heals, and love makes things grow. Love is the Band-Aid and the fertilizer. And God created us that way. And so it's really, really important, both for your personal growth, as well as to be a conduit of God's grace in the relationships that you have. To be a safe person, to be vulnerable. And it takes humility and vulnerability to open that door. And again, those are two things that we don't want to do. Because when I'm vulnerable, I open myself up to being hurt. And to humble myself, who wants to do that? But don't forget that God opposes the proud, but gives grace to the humble. So there was one blank on your front page that I didn't feel, and that is everybody has a shadow. Everybody has a shadow. And we all need relationships where we can have a few people, at least one, who knows our shadow and loves us anyway. Jesus does. But we need some Jesus with skin on too. All right, let's pray. Father, thank you for just bringing us together tonight. Lord, to just be made aware of some things that maybe we hadn't thought about before, maybe connecting some dots that hadn't been connected. Lord, this is just helpful. And Lord, my heart goes out to men like Larry and women in ministry too that struggle with the ability to be free and the ability to be loved for who they are, warts and all. Lord, your grace and truth are essential. But Lord, it is to be exercised in a place, in an environment where there is no condemnation. There is no guilt and shame, judgment or criticism or ridicule or rejection. Lord, may we be those kind of people. The safe people for each other. Where we can model the love and grace that you have given to us. Lord, we recognize that we are only able to love because you first loved us. And you demonstrated that love for us through Christ, who gave his life to pay the price for our sin. And so, Lord, knowing how much we have been forgiven, may we be the kind of people that extend that grace and forgiveness and love to each other. And Lord, may you then use those contexts, those environments, to bring about life change and transformation and spiritual growth in amazing ways through the work of your Spirit. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Everyone said?
Amen.
Thanks, everybody. God bless you guys. Mike, Linda, thanks again for opening your home to us, as always. And we'll see you in 2 weeks. I mentioned in my email that Dr. Hart wasn't able to be with us tonight because of just some family things. It wasn't an emergency. Her kids just came in town, and she really wanted to do that. So my expectation is she'll be with us in 2 weeks from now. But I don't want to say that yet because I haven't confirmed that with her. But one of the things I'd like for her to talk to us about is the effects of stress and what that does both to our soul as well as to our bodies. Her dad is probably, if he's not the leading expert in stress management and the effects of stress, he's definitely in the top 5 in the world. And so she obviously has that expertise. And then we'll talk about some other things too. So the context will probably be just me interviewing her and asking her questions, and then we'll open it up for the rest of us. So we'll take the entire night that night to just spend with her. And she's delightful. You will really enjoy getting to know her better. And I'm going to ask her to bring some of her books as well. She wrote a book not long ago called Flourish, which some of you ladies have read. And she gets into a lot of the combinations of things that I'm working on as well. But she's already got her doctorate. I was working on mine, so she beat me. So she's there. But anyway, she's great. So I hope that she'll be able to join us next time. All right?